fun. Because there are things that are very deep in the book of Revelation. Five, six, seven? I can count. some of you didn't know.
Just cheating. Is it working now?
Testing 1, 2, 3, 4. Those days are gone.
Okay.
Thank you.
Did you break it this morning or something?
You shouldn't have been stomping all it.
We've been having some problems for the last few weeks. And, today, we weren't getting it. It was too much work.
Is that what? That's not it. There. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4. That's a whole different ballgame. Okay. So we're on screen number 2. You can skip to screen number 2. Okay, we'll begin. Sorry for the delay, but I think things are working well now. Okay, 3 unclean spirits. Before we begin, I want to read Revelation chapter 16, and then I'll be reading verses 12, which we covered 2 weeks ago, all the way through 17. And the sixth angel poured out his vial upon the great river Euphrates, and the water thereof was dried up, and the way of the kings of the east might be prepared. And by the way, I have in all my documents kings highlighted. It's not king of the east, it's kings of the east. So we're going to talk about some of that later on today. And I saw 3 unclean spirits like frogs come out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet. We'll talk about each one of those today. And they are the spirits of devils working miracles, which go forth into the kings of the earth and the whole world to gather them together to that great day of God Almighty, which is the Battle of Armageddon, of course. Behold, I come as a thief. Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments, lest they walk naked and they see his shame. And he gathered them together in a place called in the Hebrew tongue, Armageddon. And the seventh angel poured out his vial upon the Okay. So I want to read 1 Thessalonians again. I read this a couple of weeks ago, but I want to read it again. Jesus is not coming as a thief to believers. Get that in your mind. We know he's coming. We do not know when he's coming, but he's given us signs so we're prepared for his coming. We just don't know when it is. Same thing with Noah and the ark. He built an ark. He put animals in the ark, and people said, "Why are you building an ark?" They laughed at him. And what did he do? He shut the door, and it started raining. When the Lord, in Luke, he says, "I'm going to shut the door, and then I'm going to send Jesus." When that happens, if we're not on the inside of the ark, God's covenant, we're in trouble. We need to be baptized and living a Christian life. Baptism alone won't do it. Anybody can jump in a pool and come out wet. We need to jump in a pool in the name of Christ and come out a renewed new man. So, 1 Corinthians chapter 5, starting in verse 4. "But you, brethren, are not in darkness, that that day should overtake you as a thief. You are the children of the light and the children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness." This is not talking about the sun coming up and the sun going down. This is talking about truth and untruth. Spiritual light and darkness. "Therefore, let us sleep, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober." This is not talking about being drunk. This is talking about being alert for the Lord. "For they that sleep, sleep in the night. They that are drunken are drunken in the night. But let us who are of the day, who are of the light, be sober, putting on the breastplate of faith and love, for an helmet of hope of salvation." So we have to be alert every day. That's the intent of prophecy. I read to you 2 Peter chapter 3. You can read the whole chapter. It's a good chapter to read every once in a while. But God said, this is going to happen in the day of Noah. This is going to happen in another day. And then he says, it's going to happen with the coming of Christ. And there were some that didn't make it the first time, some that didn't make it the second time, and there'll be some that won't make it when Jesus returns to this earth. We need to be alert. "Blessed is he that watcheth and keepeth his garments." This is not talking about having his clothes taken to the cleaners. This is talking about his spiritual garments, our righteousness. And our righteousness is as what? Filthy rags. So where do we get our righteousness from? From Jesus Christ. Isaiah 64, 6, Romans 10, 3, Revelation 19, 8. "And they see his shame, our sinfulness. And he gathered them together in a place called in the Hebrew tongue, Armageddon, which is in the valley of Jezreel, Jehoshaphat." And we talked about this last week. "And the seventh angel, the final angel, blew the trumpet, poured out his vial or his bowl or his saucer into the air, and there came a great voice out of the temple of heaven from the throne saying, 'It's done.'" That's all she wrote. It's over. This age is done. Jesus is coming. Okay, three unclean spirits like frogs again. Turn the page. Here we're going to kind of give you a quick overview, and then we'll go into detail on each one of these. So the three frogs have impure actions
and falsehoods and lies. The dragon represents atheists, a belief in no God or in false gods. The belief, the beast, is different in that it's a perversion of the truth. Rome distorted what Jesus taught, what God had presented in the Old Testament, perverted it as a lie, as a distruth, or as all kinds of other things, or mixing false gods with it. And then the false prophets are the Muslims who teach a totally different point of view. These are the lies that come, that are deceptions today. Next screen, please. Okay, so there are three unclean spirits. 1 John 4 talks about exactly what spirits are. And listen carefully to this text, because this text really tells us what spirits are. Beloved, believe not every spirit. Don't believe every religious teaching, every religious belief that's around. But try, prove, verify the spirits, those religious beliefs and teachings that are around, and their origins, where they come from. Did they come from God, Christ, and the prophets, or did they come from some other place? Because many false prophets, teachers, preachers, fake preachers, are gone into the world. Matthew 7:15, Acts 20:29-30. Hereby know you that the Spirit of God, every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh, is of God. In other, every teaching that Jesus confesses and that he came in the flesh is a truthful scriptural teaching. If one believes that Jesus did not come as a man upon this earth, first of all, 1 Timothy 2:5 would make him a liar. But also, it's important to understand that this is what Jesus is confessing, that he came in the flesh. Every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh, i.e. that Jesus is not a man, 1 Timothy 2:5, and Jesus is not human, 1 Matthew 1:21-25, or Luke 2:5-7, which is his birth, is not of God. It's false, it's anti-Christ teaching, and this is the spirit of Antichrist. It's an opposition to God and his Son, whereby we have heard that it should come, and Paul said, and John said as well, in 1 John 4, it's already now. It's not something into the future. 2 Corinthians chapter 1 and 2 in Thessalonians, and 1 John, almost every chapter in 1 John. Especially chapters 4, 2 John is good, 3 John is even better. 3 John is really powerful, talking about what is Antichrist. So then there are three unclean spirits. excuse me. The dragon, the beast, and the false prophet. We'll take one at a time and go through. Again, these are things that have happened in history that makes us understand what he's talking about. So the first one, which is the dragon, are those represented by atheists. And this is a growing number. All three of these are growing numbers today, and we'll show you how they're growing in just a little bit. The second one is the beast, or the Muslims, the beast should be the third one. The false prophet is the second one here. I have them out of order for some reason. I don't know why I did that. One of my first error ever. Okay, if you believe that. Okay. Anyway, let's look at one at a time. The dragon. Okay. The dragon, I call them those who believe in, don't believe in any god, or those who believe in false gods. I call them no godders or no gods, and false godders or gods. These are atheists. They are people who believe in gods that are not real at all, made up gods by man. China, most of the population of the world is in China, some in Russia, but there are other countries where it is prevalent as well. Buddhists is part of this group, and we'll talk about them a little bit later. China and India make up 60% of the world's population. Powerful. Next screen. This is number 10. Okay. I thought this was interesting. This is a 2021, work was done in 2021. It was published in this year, earlier this year in January. 91% of China is atheist. I just thought it was interesting to see Japan and Sweden weren't all that far behind. I thought it was interesting to see that England was 72% atheist. And what startled me more is our neighbor to the north, 63% of the people there are atheists. Why is that? Anybody know? Where do the people come from that migrate to Canada? China. China and Asia, mainly. There's a massive amount of Chinese in Canada, yeah. And United States, 43%. I've told you about this percentage a long time ago. I thought it was interesting that United States has more atheists than Russia. And why is that? Now, an atheist is somebody who believes in no god whatsoever. What do the people of China believe in? I mean in Russia, people in Russia. They're in the Russian what? Orthodox Church. The old Russian Orthodox Church. Putin himself joined a few years ago, and a lot of Russia joined after he joined. Follow the leader, right? That makes a really good dedicated Christian, right? No, it doesn't. Okay, China and Taiwan. And it's interesting. This is coming to a head. The 11th screen that we have today, China is thinking seriously about attacking Taiwan. And they have flown over it. One day, 34 jets and bombers and electronic warfare and everything else flew over in a short period of time. And they've been doing that ever since. Maybe not 34, but a massive amount of people. So, screen 12, the Buddhist dragon. The dragon is the Buddhist mark. Remember, it's a symbol of belief in no or false gods. And There's a lot of them in the Buddhist camp. However, Buddhism doesn't have a god. A lot of people have this incorrect. The dragon includes the atheistic countries of China and the Asian countries. China and the Asian countries are very much into Buddhism. These countries are known as the countries as a whole who do not believe in any god or false gods or heathen gods. Interesting enough, China, however, is different. Russia's religion is diverse, with a 1997 law naming Christianity, Islam, Buddhism, and Judaism as important in the Russian history, and of course the Russian Orthodox Christianity is the largest group of so-called Christians. We have a group there, and a pastor talked about it this morning from the pulpit, so we need to pray for our missionary there and our people as well, because a lot's happening there. So keep them in your mind. Okay, number 14 talks about what Buddhism really is. It's a religion based on the teachings of man, a man who lived 25 centuries ago in what was Nepal and northern India. He was called the Buddha, which means the awakened one. He experienced profound realization of the nature of life, death, and existence. In the English, the Buddha was said to be enlightened, or mean also awakened. He taught that awakening comes through one's own direct experience, not through belief and dogmas. 1 Corinthians chapters 12 and 14 will show that this is pure foolishness. We are not in Christianity because of our experience. We are here because of truth and obedience. Obeying truth and being obedient to truth. So the Buddha was not a god. Was not a god. He never claimed to be a god. He never claimed to be the son of God. He never claimed to be the messenger of God. He was a man who achieved nirvana through his human efforts. Next screen. Come out of the mouth of the dragon, go forth of the kings of the earth, China and India. China has a personal relationship with India for more reasons than one, but the first reason is oil. China needs oil. They get it from any place they can get it, from the Middle East, from Russia, any place they can get it. This is what has tied Russia and China together. Russia has the oil. China has the food. Why is Russia going into this little country onto their lower western part? Because they need the wheat. That's the wheat belt of that part of the world. By the way, for those of you who don't know it, Nebraska, Kansas, Oklahoma, there's major fires in Texas and Oklahoma now, right now as we speak. But there's a major drought out there. It's killed off some of the winter wheat, and that's the wheat belt of the United States. Yeah, there's other places that raise wheat, but nothing like that area. And so, as was mentioned a week or so, or 2 weeks ago, Thompson mentioned this too, and I mentioned that my friendship with the Johnsons in Minnesota, wheat has gone up this past weekend up to $10 to $11 a bushel. So your bread's going to go up. Your flour's going to go up. Anything made with flour is going to go out the top in price. China has assisted in the development of Iran's nuclear program via the transfer of technology and machinery. What is Israel considering doing? Anybody know? Anybody listen to anything other than ABC, NBC, CBS? Please listen to something else besides those three, because you only get a very little bit of truth from those three. China, Israel has become very quiet. At first, they were saying, we're going to go in and take away what China has developed in Iran. And for now months, they have not said they're going to do anything. What usually happens when Israel becomes silent? They actually do something. So I don't know that they will, but I'm just telling you what has happened in the past. So keep that in mind. So anyway, China is trying to keep United States and the West out of the Middle East and being friends with Iran and other nations in the Middle East is one way of doing this. Screen 17, noting that Iran and Russia's second target is settlement of the regional differences and helping establish peace and stability in the region. You believe that? No. If you believe that, you are Chinese or Russian. That's the only way you can believe that. Okay, later on it says here, Tehran and Moscow have said both countries share the same views over war and terrorism in the region. I believe that. They both believe that they want to take over the Middle East. So anyway, it's just interesting to see what's published and how you should interpret it. So 18, until July 15th, U.S.-backed Turkish government back in 2015 through 17 was a time when there was turmoil in Turkey. And it's really important to understand what's going on. I've got a whole bunch of texts saying, hopefully maybe the online is working now, but I've got a whole bunch of text earlier that said it wasn't working, so that's news to us, right? Anyway, however, Russian President Putin saved Erdogan's presidency in Turkey by coming in and quelching the group of people that were going to have a coup in Turkey and take over Turkey. So they helped out. They put tens of thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of people in prison, killed most of them. They didn't release them. They just killed them. And so Turkey said, thank you so much for helping us out. We appreciate it very much. You can leave now. What did Russia do? They're still there. So, welcome to the fine folks at Russia. Okay, I'm just going to summarize screen 19, what happened in Crimea. We're all familiar what in 2014 what happened in Crimea. It was decided, yeah, Numov said it's working, so we're thankful that the sound is working now, so appreciate it. Thank you, Mark. So anyway, on screen 19, Crimea was taken over by Russia, and have they left? No, they've gone into, they've used it as a screening place to go into where they're trying to take over now. So it's just interesting. There's no plans for them to leave anytime in the near future. I look at the war there now, as we turn to page 20, I look at the war there going one of two ways, and I'm really wide on this. I don't think the war is going well for Russia. So they have made an agreement. They're trying to make an agreement with Ukraine, saying, I want this. I'll show you in a little bit what they want. They want Crimea completely. They want two other sections of the land of Ukraine. And they want it right now. And they say, if you give us those areas, we'll back off. And I think they're only doing this because they really run into a... the people of Ukraine have put a real battle together. They've lost some battles, but they have really put a strong force against the people of Russia. And the Russian soldiers are not happy about Putin lying to them and saying, it's going to be a cakewalk, just go in, take over, and come home, and we'll put roses around your neck and everything. So it's interesting, United States said, we're not going to buy Russian gas. What did that do for you guys and me? Gasoline went to $4. If you got a diesel car, it went to $5.50, $6. Okay. United States went to Saudi Arabia and said, please increase your oil. And I think they might do that. I'm not sure that they're doing that. But the oil prices have stabilized for now. So who knows? Yeah. Oil prices went down and gas prices went down a few pennies. So anyway, keep in mind, Russia and China are working together. Keep in mind, the two largest armies in the world are buddy-buddies. They're working together. They did this in 2019, and they're doing it again last year and again this year. So they're working together. They had maneuvers together on land, on sea, and in the air. They had tanks that were not manned in the battlefield. So these two major countries are working together against the rest of the world. So screen number 21. This is really important. Listen carefully to the next few screens, please, because these are really important screens. Russia conducts massive military drills with China. Russia is Magog in the Old Testament. I have the scriptures. We're not going to read them. Is carried out a series of large-scale military exercises with China, the kings of the East, and India. Remember I said possibility? And Pakistan and six other stands. Countries that end with S-T-A-N, in which experts believe is Moscow trying to send a powerful message to the West. Going against the country Russia is going against now is a sign to see whether America will do anything. If China goes against Taiwan, sign number two. Will America do anything? We haven't done anything yet, so... who knows? 22. The seven stands. It's interesting what stand means. Stand means the land of. So Pakistan means the land of the Paki. Afghanistan means the land of the Afghan. So all of these seven, are they little countries that don't mean anything? Screen number 23, here's all of them in row, showing where they're at, east of Iran, north of Iran, east of the Caspian Sea, north of the Caspian Sea. Screen number 24, this is interesting. 24 says this, the country, this Pakistani group of people, these stands together, would make up 278 million people. The fourth most populated country in the world if they were one world. Remember I told you it's not just one country, it's multiple countries. It should be 5.5 million square kilometers, which would make it the seventh largest country in size behind Australia. The largest city would be Karachi, Pakistan, with a total military might of 975,000 active military personnel. Larger than the armies of South Korea, France, United Kingdom, Germany, and Russia. Some people think it should be called Stanistan. I don't know. They are united because they were once part of what? USSR. And what is their religion? Major religion, Muslim. So do the Muslims stick together? I don't need to answer that. You don't either. Okay. So screen number 25, assessing Chinese-Russians' military might. Again, this happened in 21 where they, I mentioned earlier, where they had maneuvers together and exercises together from land, sea, and air. 26, the beast. Remaining portion of the Roman government, i.e. the Roman Catholic Church, mixed with the Gentile nations. Daniel 2 covers this, and Revelation 17 covers this. Next screen, out of the mouth of the beast. I'm going to read a little bit of Daniel here. Just bear with me. I'm going to start in verse 33. His legs of iron, his feet part of iron, part of clay. Against the iron is Rome, the clay is the Gentile nations. And the fourth kingdom shall be strong as iron, remaining portions of the Roman Empire. And for as much as the iron breaks the peace and subdueth all that are around about them, the iron that breaketh these shall be breaking pieces and bruise. Whereas thou sawest the feet of toes, part of potter clay and part of iron. How well does clay and iron work together? Not at all. If you've ever worked with iron and tried to put clay with it, it won't work. It just won't work. So when Gentile nations try to work with the Roman Empire, it's never going to work. So the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly broken. And it's going to happen that way all the way through. Then we come to Revelation chapter 12. And there appeared another wonder in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon having seven heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven, 1.27 billion. And did cast them to the earth, and the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered for to devour her child as soon as it was born. So, again, the Roman Empire stood against Jesus Christ when he was born. Chapter 13, chapter 17 go into further details. Chapter 17 talks more about the second coming of the Lord. And then 1 Thessalonians 1, 6 through 9, 2 Thessalonians 2, 1 through 13, all talk about that same event. The seven heads are the seven mountains on which the woman sits. And we covered that already. And we'll cover it greater in Revelation 17 when we cover Revelation 17. So let's look at just a little bit of the nation of Israel and how different people are looking at it. Israel will disappear from the landscape of geography. We will fully recognize the Palestinian state as a landmark treaty entered into force. Pope Francis. How much truth does that have? All you have to do is read Zechariah chapter 12. Zechariah 12 or Zechariah 14, and you know it's nothing but baloney. It's not truth. Next screen. This is Revelation 17, where, and he carried me away into the spirit, into the wilderness. What is the wilderness in the Bible? The wilderness is not a desert place in the Bible, in the prophetic sense. It is a place where there is no godliness, where there's no spirituality. And I saw a woman sitting on a scarlet-colored beast full of blasphemous names, having seven heads and ten horns. When we get into Revelation, we'll show you exactly what the seven heads and the ten horns are. The woman, clothed with purple and scarlet, adorned with gold and precious stones, will show you how this is identical to the Roman Catholic Church. Next screen. We're covering this kind of fast, but I wanted to get a few more screens in before we have to close. And out of the mouth of the beast, the Roman Catholic Church has more than 1.27 members, and it's growing. And one of the oldest religious institutions in the world, headed by the Bishop of Rome, known as the Pope. And its doctrines are summarized in the Nicene Creed against what we believe and teach. And it says later on here in the text in Daniel chapter 7, and he shall speak great words against the Most High, that's Jehovah God, and wear out the saints of the Most High God, which is the persecution of the church. And he will change times and laws. The church changed from Saturday to Sunday and many other laws, and the dividing of times and so forth. And we'll get into that also in our understanding of the book of Revelation. 31 just gives you a little more understanding of what's going on. The false prophet is the Muslim faith, where there is no separation of religious and political thought or power. And that's always bad. We're thankful in America we still have the right to be able to separate our political stuff from our faith. And when we lose that, we're in tough shape. In tough shape. Let's skip on down to 33. It's just interesting that in Russia, one-fifth of the population in Russia is Muslim. 35, we go into Psalm 83 here, and notice who the false prophets, where the countries are, and they're all in the Middle East. All of these countries are in the Middle East, and they're Arab countries, essentially. And Asher was the Assyrian country, and where the Assyrian god named by Asher also was in existence. 36, screen 36 just gives you an overview to study to show you that there are three major portions of this group. There are the tents of Edom, Esau, which is northern Jordan, Moab, Lot, which is central Jordan, and Ammon, Lot, which is northern Jordan. All of that part is where Lot was, where Esau was, and it's really the part of the Arabs where they are today. We're going to skip verse number 37 because we've already covered it. We're going to look at 38 only briefly. The Islamic group that was led by Ayatollah Khomeini, Khomeini's dead, of course, since 89, and the following has not gone anywhere. The Arabs are still strong. 39, screen 39 just tells us that men may know that thou, whose name alone is Jehovah, art the most high of all the earth. Ezekiel 38 tells us that. Zechariah chapter 12 and 14 tell us that. And so does the Psalms. So does Isaiah 2, by the way. And then out of the mouth of the false prophet, this is their Mecca place where they kiss the stone and all that foolishness in Saudi Arabia. 41 shows us where Mecca is in Saudi Arabia and where they gather once a year to worship. 42 is Iran's strength and so forth of the use of the Islamic faith. 42, I'm skipping it because the Shia Muslims just beat themselves up. And, of course, 1 Corinthians 13:3 tells us that that's no way to act as believers of God. So I want to skip forward to 45, if you would. The spirits of devils working miracles. These are not miracles of God. These are events by man, which go forth into the kings of the earth and to the whole world. Are these three unclean spirits going forth? Is communism going forth? Is the Muslim faith going forth? Is the Roman Catholic Church going forth and gaining grounds? All of them are. And they're gaining grounds in the world against the Lord, not for the Lord. So if you go to 48, in the United Nations some time ago, the Roman Catholic Church wanted to make the Palestinian state a part of the United Nations. The United Nations constitution, whatever it is, would not allow it. So they got, the Vatican got, so that their flag could fly on the grounds of the United Nations. And I show you where it is and what the flag looked like in 48. And 49 tells you what Pope Francis did to get it to happen. And he spoke in our Congress back in, what year was that, on 49, it was in 2015, saying what a wonderful thing it was. And of course, just the opposite is true. So the great day of God Almighty is coming, and verse 51, screen 51, shows us where the Battle of Armageddon is going to be fought and what it looks like today. It's a garden spot in the world. 52 tells us God's wrath is going to be poured out there. 53 shows us how it's going to, the wrath of God is going to be poured out everywhere. And chapter 16, the first few verses talk about all of this. We covered the sixth bowl, which is the bowl of Euphrates, and we covered the seventh today very well. 54 tells us about the Battle of Armageddon, where they're coming from. 55 tells us about the Revelation 9:16, the army, 200 million. Again, 56 does the same thing. 57, the same thing. 58, the same thing. And 59 tells you how it's going to happen. We showed you this earlier as well. 60 shows us how they were come into the land of Israel. And Napoleon called this the perfect battlefield. And I want to read these texts on 61. This is about the end, so hang in there with me a few more minutes. How many nations are involved? The Bible says, I will gather all nations. Not all of them will be actively participating. Ezekiel 38 says some of them are saying, why are you coming down? The United States is one of those countries. And where will the battle be fought? It'll be fought in the valley of Jezreel and Jehoshaphat. Why is the battle being fought? And this is why it's being fought. And God said in Ezekiel 39:7-22, I will make my holy name known in the midst of my people Israel. So the house of Israel shall know that I am the Lord their God from that day forward. He's going to prove to Israel that he is Jehovah God. Who's in charge of the battle? Great multitudes there. The battle is not yours. God says it's mine. Who will win the battle? Past history says Jehovah will do it in 2 Chronicles 20. Stand, watch your salvation. By the way, chapters 18, 19, 20, and 21 and 2 Chronicles are fantastic reading. Watch how God wins battles. The people of Israel didn't fight with one sword, one gun, or anything, and the battle was won by the hand of Jehovah God. And that's what he's going to do in Ezekiel 38 and 39. Revelation 22:20, surely I come quickly, amen. Even so come, Lord Jesus. 63, and the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all, amen. Sorry I ran over, but we got started late. I hope you'll bear with me and not throw too many tomatoes at me. Any thoughts or questions, quick ones? This will all be out on the internet shortly so that you can look at it and ask questions later on if you have them. We will begin next week with our e-book, and it'll be in the overhead next week so that we can show you what it's going to look like and give you some very important information on the introduction to the book of Revelation. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Mighty God and our Heavenly Father, we honor you as our God. There is no anything like a God beside you. We thank you for your Son, the Messiah, Jesus, who died on our behalf, gave his life, and poured out his blood, and you caused him to rise from the grave and be our Savior to eternal life, and then at your right hand to be our mediator, our go-between, our only hope. We thank you for prophecy because it leads us to understand you're in charge and we'd better do something about it in our life. We thank you for the warnings, for the message, for the hope, and we just pray, Lord, it will touch other people who have not yet known you and your Son. We pray this all in Christ's holy name. Amen. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you for being online. We apologize for the problems tonight, but we hope you finally got on all right. Thanks again. I got a whole bunch of notes saying people are on, finally got on, so we're thankful for that. Okay, good.